The Legendarium podcast is brought to you
by you. So please visit patreon.com/legendarium
to support the show. But for now,
welcome to the Legendarium.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Legendarium podcast. Take two on that one. All right. So today is very, very weird, but I hope it's fun. People really seem to enjoy the Wheel of Tangents episodes, and so we're going to do one of those today. But here's the catch. I've got with me Drew from Inking Out Loud. Drew, say hi.
How's it going, everybody?
Now, people are going to get awfully sick of you and I doing podcast yeah. episodes together, but frankly, I don't really care because it's fun. So here's the deal. Right now, we are live streaming on the Legendarium YouTube channel. I have been live streaming now for 3 hours and 45 minutes, with a 10-minute break in there somewhere. So this has already been a mega stream, and this is for the 4,000 mark on our subscriber count. Okay, so thank you everybody for subscribing. If you haven't done yet, you should go do so, and enjoy some fun videos on the Legendarium's YouTube channel. But during this live stream, I decided it might be fun to do an entire episode front to back and show people the process of how this goes. And so I don't think you'll be able to watch this later, unfortunately, because YouTube only uploads the first 3 hours of your stream. But for those enjoying this live stream right now, you will get to see the entire process. And I'll do it again, you know, maybe the next time we do one of these mega streams, I'll do the same thing again. But anyway, Drew, you and I are going to do a very simple, very straightforward Wheel of Tangents episode. We're going to address a few randomized topics from the fans, and then we'll show them the entire process of editing an episode, packing it up, and publishing it, and how it all goes. So,
sounds good.
You ready?
Yeah.
Now, I should also mention, obviously, that people can check out Drew at IOLpodcast.com. Is that right?
Yes.
Oh, I got it right. So, the Inking Out Loud podcast, it's similar in a lot of ways to the Legendarium, just more structured and interesting and fun. So you should go check it out. I should say it's similar to what we do. You guys just cover some different books than we do. So
yeah, and my co-host and I are both writers, so we kind of approach our analysis from a little more of a like kind of breaking down the gears and mechanisms of storytelling. So it's a little, that's where that more structured thing comes in.
Right, right. Yeah. Anyway, so if you enjoy what we do, then go check them out, and vice versa.
Yes.
So Drew, all right, let's spin the wheel. And we've got a few topics, and what I'll do, we have four topics, and what I'll do is I have eight, wedges here on the Wheel of Tangents, and whichever one the mic points to, it'll just be like 1 and 2, 3 and 4, 5 and 6, or 7 and 8. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah.
So we'll do two wedges per topic. All right. So here we go. Spinning the wheel. What's the mic going to point at? It's on 3 and 4. So that is subgenres. Okay. So this is a listener question. What makes a subgenre great? And by the way, for those of you in the chat still, let me know if I'm getting the question wrong or if you want us to nuance it up a little bit. But what makes a subgenre great? I know the wording was slightly different, so somebody can correct me there.
Yeah, I think it was like, what makes one of your favorite subgenres great?
Okay, all right. Now, Drew, I kind of want you to take this one first because I don't want to immediately go into my rant on subgenres as a concept. So why don't you take this one first?
Okay. I am going to go with, I'm going to go with military fantasy. And I'm going to specifically talk about Glenn Cook. And okay. I think there was an explosion in fantasy writers in the 80s, where you got a lot of, especially American authors, men who fought in Vietnam and came back and were unsatisfied with the kinds of stories that were being told in terms of fantasy. And Glenn Cook kind of led the charge in terms of bringing story down from the standard high fantasy about kings and princes and prophesied heroes and gods and whatnot. He said, you know, I want to write a story for the grunts. I want to write a story for the guys whose boots are on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the defining aspects of this subgenre is the bond of brotherhood in arms. And I love that sort of exploration of relationships, the constant danger and the monotony of the life of a soldier forges a very specific, unique sort of bond between warriors, between soldiers.
All right. Yeah, that's good. I mean, how many times, you and I have known each other for, what, 2.5 years-ish now? How many times do you think you have told me to read Glenn Cook in 2.5 hours? What's the number? Let's quantify this.
Oh, at least a dozen.
That's your point. You're being awfully charitable to yourself here. So that one doesn't surprise me. Oh, excuse me. Wow. I'm dying here. This is what happens when you stream for 4 hours and then record an episode, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. This is a bit like Drew when we did our Wheel of Time thing at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Oh man, that was rough.
Okay. A subgenre that I really like. I don't know if it's like my favorite subgenre, but a subgenre that I really like is space fantasy. And I am I'm making this distinct from science fiction. And so those who love making distinctions like this, they already know about this distinction. But Star Wars is not sci-fi. Just because it has lasers doesn't mean it's sci-fi. It's space fantasy, right? Very little actual science goes into the making of a space fantasy. And I love this subgenre. And what makes it great? Why do I like it? Well, because the whole concept of space, like one of the things that I love so much about stories, any story set in space, is the frontier aspect of it. The idea of exploration, limitless possibilities, et cetera, et cetera. You get where I'm going with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so the space fantasy just kicks that up another notch and just says, hey, as long as we're exploring and breaking all the rules and having fun out on the frontier, let's really go for it. So, Drew, I know you're a huge fan of the what are they called? What's the thing? The Cytonic, Skyward?
Oh, Skyward, yeah, Cytoverse. Series. Yeah.
The Cytoverse. Yeah. That's a Sanderson series set in space, and it's very much space fantasy, right?
Yes. Oh, yes. Especially so after this most recent book.
Right. So just magic and, you know, telepathy and all sorts of, you know, just like there are no rules here. Let's just have some fun in space. I don't know. I really like that aspect of the subgenre. So, you know, as long as we're talking about Star Wars, you guys have done a bunch of Star Wars novels on your podcast, like the X-Wing series and whatnot.
Yeah.
Where it's like you love them, but you have to suspend your scientific mind and say like, no, this is not how dogfights in space would work.
Right.
I'm not reading Joe Haldeman or what? Who was it that we did? What was the name of it? Lost Fleet. Jack Campbell. Lost Fleet. That's very much like this is how space battles would actually work, and it's awesome, but also a lot more boring than reading an X-Wing novel. So
yeah.
Anyway, yeah. There you go. How's that? That's my subgenre.
I like it. That's a good choice.
All right. So I think some of the chat is agreeing with me that space fantasy is good. So good. Awesome. What you meant to say, says Brian Weingard, is that The Expanse is more specifically sci-fi. Oh, I don't know. Maybe somebody else was talking about that. But yeah, like something like The Expanse, they do try to make it more scientific. And that's, don't get me wrong, that's awesome. I love sci-fi. I'm not trying to say like, I don't like sci-fi. This is why I like space fantasy. So mm-hmm. There you go. All right, Drew, what do you think? Should we spin again?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. I forgot to even put that one on screen. All right. And this is 1-2. So this is Reading Burnout. Reader Burnout. Drew, I burned out so hard I guess I'll take this one first. And, yeah. and let me know, folks in the chat, let me know what specifically you want us to get into. But I guess we could talk about, like, why do we burn out? How do we get out of it? What has caused us to burn out? I burned out so hard after Rhythm of War. It was rough. Like, I could barely pick up a book after Rhythm of War.
Any book at all, not just Sanderson.
Oh yeah, no. I all I wanted to do was watch a screen for like 6 months. Like movies, I watched so many movies, so much TV because I couldn't pick up a book. I was so burned out. So for those who don't know, Rhythm of War, fourth book in the Stormlight Archive, and there are Doorstoppers, and then there's the Stormlight Archive, where each book is three novels in one, in terms of length and structure. Well, sort of structure,
as well as a novella and a half dozen short stories.
Yes, correct. So these books are crazy huge, and I was Ryan and I got the advanced review copy so we could read it ahead of time and have an episode ready to go on the podcast. That's great. But I was like, oh, you know what, it's been a few years since I read the other ones, so I did a reread of the entire Stormlight Archive. And then we got the advanced copies, and I had like a week, if that. I think I had like 3 days to read the Rhythm of War.
Yeah, I think and you were out here visiting.
That's right, when I started. It. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so it was like every waking moment was consumed with the Stormlight Archive, and that caused my burnout. Have you ever had something similar happen to you?
So, not to that extreme, but Rhythm of War, Sanderson burnout was real. We did all of Mistborn Era 1, two or three of the Arcanum Unbounded novellas, and then read all four books in Stormlight plus the Stormlight novellas for Inking Out Loud leading up to the release of Rhythm of War. On top of that, I did the beta read for Rhythm of War, and the gamma read for Rhythm of War, and the beta and the gamma for Dawn Shard. So 2020 was just this avalanche of Cosmere, of Brandon Sanderson. And when I finished, you know, recording our Rhythm of War episodes, I was like, I have no desire to read another word written by Brandon Sanderson. And it got to the point where even though I really enjoyed Starsight, when the word came down that the Cytonic beta read was happening, I told Peter no. I was like, I'm going to sit this one out. I can't do it. And it took me until the beta read for The Lost Metal a couple weeks ago, where I was able to like read and enjoy Brandon Sanderson again almost a year later.
Yeah.
But I read a lot of other stuff in the meantime. I've
burned out on a specific author. Yeah. I just had general burnout.
Yeah,
which is rough when you do a sci-fi fantasy book club podcast.
Yeah. The only time I've ever had a real burnout was after reading Book of the New Sun by Gene Wolfe, where everything else just felt bland after finishing Citadel of the Autarch. And I tried to pick up three or four different books, and I was like, this sucks. This is boring. Like, and it took me a solid month before I read another book after that. And that was Brandon dropping Bands of Mourning and Secret History on the same day.
Oh gosh. That was a heck of a day, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That time
Brandon secretly wrote a novel and a novella.
So I got to skip past that and ask you, what did you do about it? What do you do about it? And what should people do? And so if they experience burnout, and this is for, I should say real quick, this is for those of us who have what I'm talking about, long burnout. Apparently Starcast is on here and says, that this is relatable. I don't have long burnouts, says Starcast, but Rhythm of War was my longest one. Read it in 3 days, and the next three, I didn't read anything. Like, that's short burnout. I'm talking more about long burnout. What do you do if it's like, oh, it's a month and I can't seem to get back on the horse?
I don't know if I have a good answer to this because it's only happened to me once. And yeah. Brandon Sanderson came in to save the day, where there was the hype that got me past the like critical reading, block that I had.
Yeah.
But in terms of preventing burnout, I think my approach is similar to how Brandon Sanderson writes books, where he doesn't burn out on writing because he's constantly moving in different projects.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He doesn't write 3 Stormlight books in a row because that would burn him out. Right. He writes a Stormlight book and then he takes 2 years off to, write a YA book and a middle grade book and then another Cosmere or whatever. He's kind of keeping the creative wheels turning. And I do a similar thing where I'm reading at minimum 3 or 4 books at a time. And with Inking Out Loud, I have very specifically planned out our episodes. So if you go back and look, even though we've covered some really long series, Wheel of Time, Dresden Files, Cosmere stuff, every 4 or 5 episodes or so, you're going to see a non-that series episode pop in.
Yeah.
Where I'm constantly shuffling through, like, here's a standalone. Here's the first book in another series that we're going to finish down the road. Here's a novella, or I'm making sure that we're not just stuck in a rut of mm-hmm. reading the same thing over and over and then eventually hitting a wall where you just don't care anymore, or you're not interested in reading. You're not excited to pick up a book.
Right. Right. Well, here's how I have dealt with it and how so this Rhythm of War burnout for me was really recent. And I've already told people on the show, like, I think I referenced this when we did our first Prydain book, the Book of Three. But the reason we picked up those books was because of my burnout, where I picked up Brian McClellan. Please don't think that this is any sort of reflection on Brian McClellan. It's not. It's a reflection of my burnout, where I picked up The Promise of Blood. I opened it up, read the first couple chapters, and just couldn't care. And it wasn't about him. It was not about his book. I just couldn't bring myself to care because I was so burnt out. And so I went to Ryan and said, we should do Prydain. And the reason I said that is because it's simple, it's short, it's a kid's book, and it's something that I already knew. So I'm not saying this is the way that everybody has to do it, but just something that people can consider. If you're like super burned out and you just don't want to pick up the next thing, do a reread of something that you read earlier in life. Which is, I think, a good way to help get over burnout in just the nostalgia. Like, okay, it's a comfort food. This is, it's this comfort blanket that that helps me to, feel like safe and fun with reading again. But also, I love the idea of rereading something from your earlier years because it can be a valuable exercise to see what's different, what's changed about you in the time since you last read the book. Yeah. So it's like, it's useful, it's fun, and it can help with your burnout. I don't know. That's my idea.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that what you did with Magic Kingdom for Sale? Didn't we read that right after Rhythm of War?
I believe you may be right. Yeah. And I think I read that book for the first time when I was like 11. Maybe something like that. Exactly. So there you go. And it didn't quite cure it. So I needed to go all the way back to Prydain. But things are a lot better now. But my burnout is a lot better.
That's good.
It looked like you were about to say something. You go ahead. I'm going to check the chat, see what other people are saying about it.
No, that was definitely the Magic Kingdom for Sale was my point. In chat, I see somebody saying they're shocked at how many times I've read Kingkiller. Yes, I have read Kingkiller a lot. I haven't touched it in a long time because of everything around Patrick Rothfuss these days. I'm not spending my time waiting for authors to write new books because there are so many other books out there for me to read.
Indeed.
Not to say that I never reread. I just don't reread nearly as often. And I have found other series that I like more than Kingkiller. That it's like, if I'm going to spend the time to reread, I'm going to go sit down and pick up The Acts of Cain or The Black Company or something like that. So
yeah. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's burnout. Best of luck to people with burnout. It's a real issue. I can't say that I'm wholly cured yet, but you know, it might finally do it for me. I was just telling people on the chat before you came on, and I'll say it again. Drew and I both beta read the new The Lost Metal, book four from Mistborn, Era 2. Okay, so Wax and Wayne, book four, we've both read it. Mm-hmm. And we can't tell you anything about what happens in it, but we can tell you that we read it. And the thing I think that is finally going to cure me isn't having read the book. It's going to be how much fun I'm going to have watching people read the book next year.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that might be the thing that finally shakes me out of my long-term feeling of burnout. So there you go. All right. So let's take that one off. All right. Let's spin the wheel. Oh, there's only two more possibilities, Drew, but we'll see which one we land on. This is actually working out really well.
Seven, eight.
All right. So, and I liked this one. Drew, host of Inking Out Loud.
Yes, sir.
You're forced to do an episode on a certain book. What are you praying it's not? Okay. Now, as you think about your answer on this, let me set this up a little more here. I'm sitting currently in the Legendarium studio. Okay. It's this delightful structure that was built in my backyard by myself and my father, who was, I couldn't have done it without him. But I also couldn't have done it without the help of our generous patrons. And we did a pledge drive, or not a pledge drive, just a donation drive. And the way that we did it was, we kind of had a list of like, all right, here are five, I think it was four or five series that we think we'll probably get to. And you can vote for which one we should do next. And the idea was, this is not a democracy. It's a straight up plutocracy. So the more you give, the more you vote. Every dollar you give is a single vote. And that is why we did Narnia on the show. Because, you know, people were coming in, they're like, hey, here's $5. I want you to read this thing. Here's $10. There were some really generous people giving $20, $30. Somebody comes in and drops, I think it was like $300 or $400 on Narnia. They really wanted us to read Narnia. So, which was fine. Like, I love Narnia. I wasn't super excited to do it on the show, though. I wasn't praying that it wouldn't be Narnia, but it was the one I was least excited about from the list that we had. And somebody was like, do Narnia, here's $300. And then some other people came in and like, and ended up, you know, it ended up Narnia had like 500 or 600 votes or something like that. It was crazy. So this has happened. And thanks to that, we built the studio, but we had to read Narnia, the one we were least excited to read. Okay, so what would be yours? What do you think?
So I want to talk about the question first, okay, before I get into this, because there were two questions, kind of two similar but not quite the same questions that we had options. One of them was, you know, what series will you never read?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And then this one is, you know, what are you hoping you don't want to do? For Inking Out Loud, especially, those are wildly different questions, because just because a book is bad or not enjoyable to read for me doesn't mean it's going to be a bad episode of Inking Out Loud, because there are going to be things we can dig into in terms of writing style and structure. Why is the story not working? Why do we think it's a bad book? Honestly, one of my least favorite books I've read this year was Ready Player One, but that was one of my favorite episodes we've ever done. And yeah, like, yeah, that was a raucous time. It was so much fun recording that episode, but I hated the book.
On a limb? I can't remember if I listened to that episode. I'm betting Rob loved it.
Rob, I don't think he loved the book. He liked the movie.
I hate that stupid movie, but I love the book. So anyway, yeah, we could have some fun talking about that.
Yeah, we that one was also a Patreon recommended thing, but it was my coworker, another Rob, who
made you
forced
do it.
Us to read it, and yeah, and I forced him to read it with us and come on the episode. So it was great fun. But So my answer to this question, so a roundabout way to get there, but it would be a book that is uninteresting in what the author's doing. It would be something that's just standard tropey, you know, maybe something like The Belgariad. I feel like I just wouldn't have much of interest to say about The Belgariad.
All right.
A book sort of like that, I don't think would make a good episode of Inking Out Loud, and I wouldn't have fun talking about it.
I think that's fair enough. If it's me, okay, you're forced to do an episode on a certain book. What are you praying it's not? Let me look at my bookshelf over here. I think I've already talked about this earlier on our mega stream here, but it might be Inheritance by Christopher Paolini. There are some others, I think, that might make the list. But yeah, let's stick with that one for now. And here's why. I do have some good things to say about Aragon and that series generally. I am not out to like just crap on the series or whatever. But I have tried so many times to read Inheritance and I just can't do it. I can't do it. It's not happening. It's not a thing that will ever... like. I think I've tried... at least three times to finish the book. And I just like, and it's not like I throw it away in disgust. I get so bored and I'm so uninterested that I forget to come back to it. And then 3 months pass and I'm like, yeah. Okay. Never mind. And so if you're forced to do an episode on a certain book, what are you praying it's not? I'm praying it's not that one because I'm afraid of what would happen if I actually tried to force myself through that entire series again. So there you go. Starcast says anything that goes into the more steamy territory of fantasy romance, I just can't read it.
no Kashiel's dart for Starcast.
I actually don't. I don't have a problem with that. I used to listen to This American Life a lot. Did you ever listen to that show on NPR?
Once or twice. I haven't in a long time.
Yeah, but you're familiar with the concept of This American Life. So it's a radio show for those who don't know. And they just do a ton of different stories, you know. So they'll do 15, 20 minute segments on these different stories. And sometimes they'll get to a story where they'll put a disclaimer up front and say, just as a heads up, in this segment, we do acknowledge the existence of sex. And that's their way of, I've always loved that formulation. And I kind of feel that way when I read a book with some sexiness in it, where I'm like, hey, it's okay. I'm an adult. I can acknowledge the existence of sex. I'm not Ken. it's okay. It's okay. I don't really have a problem with that myself. So anyway, right. Says Little Red says, so do a Chuck Tingle book. I'm shocked I didn't get fired one day for I was reading the descriptions of Chuck Tingle books at in the cafeteria at lunch one day, and we were all just dying laughing. All right, so let's...
It's a time-honored tradition, just reading the titles of Chuck Tingle books aloud to your friends who don't know about Chuck Tingle.
Exactly.
Unbelievable.
It's so funny. reading we read an excerpt from the one about the the helicopter that's
the
making love
helicopter.
To a making love to a stegosaurus. No, it's a different one. It's a different one. Anyway, it's really hilarious.
That is not safe for work, LRB says.
No. okay. Do we have the last topic, and we can go for a few more minutes here, I guess. Bookshelf organization. This is a topic that somebody threw out, and it's the last one on the list. I don't know how much we're going to have to say about this on an audio podcast without actually looking at a bookshelf. But Drew, just in a couple of moments, tell me by author, by genre, by series, by color, by is it all alphabetized? What do you do?
By author and by how much I like the series. So
there's a place of honor on your bookshelf.
Like,
is that right?
Behind me here in on the screen, you can see there are two shelves kind of perpendicular to each other. The one facing us, that is my like Brandon Sanderson shelf, basically. Those are all the leather bounds on the top one, you know, and then there's a couple other shelves. And then down at the bottom, it's like, okay, some miscellaneous books. The one that's facing away, that one is the non-Sanderson My Favorite Authors. That's where I have Glenn Cook on the top shelf, Gene Wolfe on the top shelf, Matthew Stover, you know.
Yeah, I love how these are literally top shelf authors. Like, you might as well label one of them. It's like, oh, yes, this is the Glenn Morangie 15. This is the 30-year Ardbeg whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, that's this is my signed advanced uncorrected proof of The Land of Cross by Gene Wolfe, like, you know. but yeah, so I go by author and by how much I like it. Genre, yeah, Doesn't really matter.
Have you ever counted your books, Drew?
No.
No. Okay. Yeah, I did a count. I want to say it was like late last year maybe. And we, in our household, we ended up, I want to say it was about 1,200 copies of just various books. I guess it was more than that because I would count each copy of the Lord of the Rings as one, even though sometimes three different spines. So yeah, a lot of different books. That being said, so I only say that to say we have a lot of books for, you know, for a 21st century young married couple. We have a lot of books. And yet I know my collection. It's not so many that I don't know my collection. So I have never felt that much of a need to like really carefully craft out my bookshelf organization just because like I know where it all is. I don't know. Maybe call me crazy. The one thing I will say is that I do have a shelf dedicated entirely to books that we have read for the podcast.
Yeah.
And so not just a shelf, but I mean like a whole series of shelves. What are we getting? Some comments? I haven't
Matt,
even been looking.
Matt Hatch just dropped in to say he's impressed people have time to read.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Matt is here. Matt, tell me in the chat if you want me to send you a link. We'll bring you in here. You can come hang out. You don't even have to host. yeah, but I would gladly bring Matt in here. Okay, Drew, shall we wrap this little Wheel of Tangents up?
Yeah. Yeah.
I hope people enjoy it. People seem to enjoy when we just kind of shoot the breeze about random topics like this. So let us know on Discord, on the, you know, Facebook comments or what the socials. I don't know, all the different places. YouTube is what I was trying to say. Let us know what your answers to all these questions would be. I am genuinely interested in hearing. I spend most of my Discord time in the episode discussion channel. And even if I don't talk a ton, I love reading people's comments on the episodes we put out. So I'll be interested to hear what everybody has to say.
And I want to find out if there are any psychopaths in Discord, you know, who sort by color of book or something like that, you know, just so I can be aware, you know.
Is that not, that's not a thing for you?
I remember seeing some article in like a home living magazine, mm-hmm, that was talking about how you should rearrange your books by color. And I was like, this is a person who does not read. Like they treat books as trophies and decorations, not as things to consume.
Yeah. Well, people let us know. Go to thelegendarium.com. You can find a link to Discord. Go to iolpodcast.com. I bet you guys have a link to your Discord as well. We'd love to hear from people there. Regardless, thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.